Father, once again, thank you for the opportunity to come, the opportunity to do our best to honor, love, and adore you this morning. And Father, through the songs we sing and the word that is read, and Father, through communion and offering, and just through all of it, we just pray that we honor you. Father, just take this service as our gift to you this morning. Inhabit it with us. We pray this in your Son's name. Amen.
Please stand.
These are the days of your servant. For our scripture reading this morning, I wanted to read you a little bit of what I've been studying in Revelation. I made a commitment to stick with it in Revelation because my first thought is like, I won't understand it. I'll get frustrated and everything else. So I'm just like taking real slow, verse by verse, chapter by chapter, come up with a question, I look it up, and it's helped a lot. And I want to read you now. It's the segment, it's chapter 4, the whole chapter, it's 11 verses, and it's between the time of John's initial explanation of what's going on, and before they start getting into the seven seals and all those components there. So bear with me. Behold, a door standing open in heaven, and the first voice which I heard, like the sound of a trumpet speaking with me, said, "Come up here, and I will show you what must take place after these things." Immediately I was in the Spirit, and behold, a throne was standing in heaven, and one sitting on the throne. And he who was sitting was like a jasper stone and a sardius in appearance, and there was a rainbow around the throne like an emerald in appearance. Around the throne were 24 thrones. Upon the thrones I saw 24 elders sitting, clothed in white garments and the golden crowns on their heads. Out from the throne came flashes of lightning and sounds and peals of thunder. And there were seven lamps of fire burning before the throne, which are the seven spirits of God. And before the throne there was something like a sea of glass, like crystal. And in the center around the throne, four living creatures full of eyes in front and behind. The first creature was like a lion, the second creature like a calf, and the third creature had a face like that of a man, and the fourth creature was like a flying eagle. And the four living creatures, each one of them having six wings, are full of eyes around and within, and day and night they do not cease to say, and this is the part that stands out to me, they do not cease to say, "Holy, holy, holy is the Lord God, the Almighty, who was, and who is to come." And when the living creatures give glory and honor and thanks to him who sits on the throne, to him who lives forever and ever, 24 elders will fall down before him who sits on the throne and will worship him who lives forever and ever and will cast their crowns before the throne saying, "Worthy are you, our Lord and our God, to receive glory and honor and power. For you created all things, because of your will they existed and were created."
All of you is more than enough.
He fought our battle against sin because he took sin on, because he defeated death itself. We're here today, able to come before this table, remembering the sacrifice he made, the blood that was shed, the body that was torn for us. You see, we're not worthy. Never could be worthy. Couldn't make ourselves worthy to come to this table. But he makes us worthy. It's he who makes us righteous that we can approach the throne of God this morning and sit with him and commemorate his son. And so prepare your minds, prepare your hearts to remember him who paid the ultimate price for us that we could live for him. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for another opportunity to recall what your son did for us, and how much you loved us and he loved us too, to do the things that were done for us. Father, we're not worthy, but you make us worthy. We're not righteous, but you make us righteous. And Father, you make us capable of coming to this table this morning to take of these emblems to remember your son and his sacrifice. Father, we just pray that you'll bless the emblems, bless those who partake. We pray this in your son's name. Amen. Then offering, we get to offer back a portion of that which he has blessed us with. And gosh, every week I see more and more and more of how God blesses and takes care of us and does the things he does. And he's faithful to take care of us. And so we're, and through our offerings, are faithful to supply to him that which is used to reach others, to save the lost. And this morning we want to give joyfully to him that we can rejoice in that people are coming to know him through churches like us and people like us that share his word and share his church. So let's just bless the gift, bless the givers this morning. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you again for the opportunity to give to you. Father, we just, as always, pray that we can rightfully use those gifts that people can be drawn to you through them, that people come to know the saving grace that you give. And Father, we just love you and thank you for blessing us in this life, and now it's our turn to return the blessing to you. Father, we just pray that it's used rightfully in your kingdom. We pray all this in your Son's name. Amen.
Humble thyself in the sight of the Lord. Humble thyself in the sight of the Lord.
With you and the holiness and sincerity that are from God. We have done so accordingly to worldly, not according to worldly wisdom, but according to God's grace. For we do not write you anything you cannot read or understand. And I hope that as you have understood us in part, you'll come to understand fully that you can boast of us just as we boast of you in the day of our Lord. Because I was confident of this, I planned to visit you first so that you might benefit twice. I planned to visit you on my way to Macedonia and to come back to you from Macedonia, and then to have you send me on my way to Judah. Then, when I planned this, did I do it lightly, or do I make my plans in a worldly manner so that in the same breath I can say yes, yes, and no, no? But surely as God is faithful, our message to you is not yes and no. For the Son of God, Jesus Christ, who was preached among you by me and Silas and Timothy, was not yes and no, but in him it has always been yes. For no matter how many promises God has made, they are yes in Christ. And so through him, the amen is spoken by us to the glory of God. So the yes of Christ, he fulfills the things that are there. We're going to talk today about promises. How many of you in here have ever made a promise? How many of you in here have ever broken a promise? God throughout the Bible made promises. How many has he broken?
None.
How many of you have any idea how many promises God has made? If you start at Genesis and you go to Revelation, his name Everett Storm was a school teacher who took on the thing of, okay, I'm going to find out how many promises are really in the Bible. And he started from the beginning. It took him 2.5 years to go through and read and study it and do the thing. And he came up that there's just over 8,800 promises made by God. What? How many of you know all 8,800 promises? How many of you know one promise? What one do you know?
Promise to never leave nor forsake us.
Promise to never leave nor forsake us. We all know that promise. That's you're just right on target. What does that stand for? Do you know the whole verse? Anybody? Know the whole verse? It's found in Hebrews chapter 13, verse 5, where he says, never will I leave you, never will I forsake you. That's the second part of the verse. The first part of the verse says this: keep your lives free from the love of money and be content in what you have, because God has said, never will I leave you, nor will I forsake you. So what we're going to find out throughout the Bible is God made promises based on our actions. So if you want the promise, I will never leave you nor forsake you, you have to do this first part. Keep your lives free from the love of money and be content with what you have, because God has said it. Because of this promise, God's presence, we can live free from the love of money and become more content in life if we do this. If we do this, he will never leave us nor forsake us. Oof. Anybody here love money?
Mm-hmm. That's the truth.
Anybody here chase a dollar?
Mm-hmm.
You know, and do things? I mean, that word, be content where you are and with what you have. Oof. We live in the world of I want more. Anybody here ever wanted more? Boy, if I could just This 4,700 square foot house isn't enough, man. If I had 5,000 square foot, the things I could do for God. There's not things you do for God, and you do for you. So we're going to be talking about these promises and go through them. Here's some promises God has said. God promised us eternal life. God promised us guidance. He promised us Christ's return. He promised us rest in Him. He promises us great victory. He promised answered prayers. He promised wisdom. He has promised peace. He's promised God's presence. And He's promised forgiveness. How many of those prayers do you hold on to? I know we all hold on to the last one, don't we? Man, the promise of forgiveness, I'll claim it all day long. To be forgiven, to be made pure again, to be His. We'll do those things. But promises that God made all have specific meaning, specific purpose. I mean, He'll do it if my people who are called by my name should humble themselves and pray and turn from their wicked ways. There's a promise there. Then I will heal their land. I mean, a lot of us pray about God, we got to turn America around. We got to do that. Have you done your part? If my people who are called Christian would humble themselves. First step's a tough one, isn't it? To be humble. To not be proud. But to be humble. Pray. Seek Him. Turn from your wicked ways. How many of you have wicked ways? I mean, it's the battle of life, right? God, Satan, and He makes things look so good and so tantalizing and so that we're like, surely that would hurt. If my people who are called by my name should humble themselves, pray, and turn from their wicked ways. We can't any longer claim what Satan's offering if we're going to thank Christ. Can't serve two masters. I put together some pointers about promises. To put them in their full context, full meaning, be willing to accept all of God's promises, not just the ones you like. And I say that because here, John 16:33, in this world you will have trouble. How many of you want to claim trouble? But take heart, I have overcome the world. Promising us, I've overcome it, you'll overcome it, I'll help you overcome it, I'll be there for you. But understand, there are going to be troubles. Why are there troubles? Well, we can go all the way back to the beginning, right? In the garden, Adam and Eve. What was the premise of living in the garden? When God put them there, He planned on them being there how long?
Forever.
He said, man, these are my people. I'm going to love them forever, and they're going to love me. But sin crept in, didn't it? Sin. And Satan didn't say, I'll give you all the money in the world, did he? No. I'll give you all the power in the world, did he? No. He just asked them a question. Surely will you die? Eat of this. What did he mean? You will die? became of that sin? Well, hard labor for your goods, pain in childbirth. The worst thing that came from it, death. No longer will they live forever in the garden, but they're going to have to go out and work for it and toil and do the things, and death came. And then came the battle between God and Satan. And we're in that battle right now. And we're fighting that battle. And we know this. If we choose God, if we choose Jesus, they're going to be with us through it. And they're going to guide us and direct us and lead us. They promised us that, right? And if we do it right, the promise is eternal life. The promise is we get heaven. When Jesus said, I go to prepare a place for you. If I go to prepare a place for you, surely I'll come back and take you to where I am, right? And that place is heaven. That's not just a statement, hey, I'm going to go build this place and, you know, I might come back. No, he said, I will come back and I will what? Take you to where I am. Where is that? How do you get there? See, when you read the rest of that scripture there, they say, well, Lord, where are you going to be? And how do I know how to get there? And what's the ending of that? What does Jesus say in response? I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. I'm it. And then he went from that place and through scripture and gave his life for us to show us that he was certainly the way. That he was certainly the truth and the life. And if we want what God is promising in the scriptures, we have to take the gift. How many of you have the gift? 3, 4, 5, 6. So I'm preaching to the rest of you. You have to have the gift. What's the gift?
The Holy Spirit.
The Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit. The part of them left to guide us, direct us, lead us. I mean, Jesus promised it to us. Here, I'm going to lead this to get us through. And in order to get that Holy Spirit, I have to accept Jesus as my Lord and Savior. I have to say, okay, you're mine. And if you're mine, then who can take me? You see, if I'm truly his, Satan has no power over me. If I'm living the promises of God, Satan has already lost. Oh gosh, with Jesus, he's already lost. We're just claiming what has already happened, right? How many of you have no doubt whatsoever that if Jesus came back in the next 10 seconds, you'd be in heaven with him? I mean, no doubt. No. Think I'm ready. No maybes. If you think you're ready, a maybe and something like that, man, you got a lot of work to do and you got to do it in a hurry. One promise that is now found in the Bible, you have it tomorrow. We're not promised a tomorrow. You won't find it there. We're finite people hoping for an infinite ending. You see, I could drop right here, right now. Had a preacher friend 2 weeks ago who was or last week, getting ready to celebrate his 40th anniversary with the church. They're getting doing the stuff, and he's playing guitar, singing a song, and dropped on the stage. What a way to celebrate your 40th, right? He's had a quadruple bypass surgery. He's still on a ventilator a week later, struggling to get through and do the things that get back to where he should be. We're not promised. That could just as well be any one of us. I mean, we talked about in Sunday school a young girl who just graduated University of Tennessee and going on to be an officer in the military, and her boyfriend shot and killed her. Whole promising life ahead of her and gone. We are not promised a tomorrow. So what do you do today to secure your promise of an eternity with Him? The answer is not, I went to church on Sunday. It's good. It informs you and builds you up and strengthens your walk and stuff like that, but just going to church on Sunday isn't enough, is it, Harvey? No. What does it take? It takes that promised relationship between you and Him. And part of that promise is, I'll serve you. Not my will, but yours be done. Same prayer that Jesus said in the garden is what we say to Him. Not my will, Father, in this life, use me however you need and see fit to use me. Not what I want, what do you want? You see, we got so used to, in our young lives, of I want, I want, I want. I mean, I have a 3-year-old grandson, and I'm seeing that. Happy, I want. Boy, you'd like to buy him the world, but you can't. He doesn't realize it, but what he really wants, what he really needs, is Jesus. I mean, he's getting it. They go to church. If there's anybody you've ever seen that loves church, it's that boy. And he goes and he's part of it. But it's us teaching them the promises of God. I want an eternity in heaven. And so to get it, I have to claim the promises. Am I willing to accept the promises with the work that comes with them? Easy to accept the promises. It's easy to say, He'll never leave me nor forsake me, but keep your lives free from the love of money and be content with what you have because God has said it. A little bit different. To accept in this world, you're going to have trouble. How many of you make trouble because life's boring? Troubles just come, right? I mean, you really don't have to search them out. They come, but take heart. I've overcome the world. The ultimate aim of God's promises to us is the glorifying of Himself. Fulfill your promises in your servant so that you may be feared and I may be glorified. Fulfill your promise to your servant so that you may be feared and I may be glorified. Some promises, like I said, are conditional. For if you carefully keep all these commandments, which I have commanded you to do, to love the Lord your God, to walk in all His ways, to hold fast to Him, then the Lord will drive out all these nations from before you, and you will you will dispossess greater and mightier nations than yourself. He'll take care of the problems if we get the first part. Love the Lord your God, walk in all His ways, hold fast to him. Action. Action. How many of you love the Lord your God? How many of you hold fast to him? How many of you walk always with him? I took it out of context a little bit because I put that last because that word always trips you up. Always is a consistent, continual, happening, constant. Walking with God. And I can tell you that I took a walk this week with Tracy. Have you ever walked with yourself? Put yourself first. Do what you want to do, not what he's pushing you to do. And that word always trips me up every time. I can say, well, I consistently do, or I attempt to, or I'm trying to, but to be able to say I always do. So that means I always don't have that promise, do I? If I step outside of it, I have to get it straight from him. Promises must be appropriate and applied by faith. Oof. Let's just skip it. How's your faith fit into God's promises? First of all, they're assuming something, that you have faith. Everybody here have faith? Anybody not have faith? I mean, we have faith in things that don't even need faith. I mean, I have faith that when I go out and turn the key in my car, it's going to start. That's a form of faith, isn't it? I have faith that when I pull up to the stoplight, sooner or later it's going to turn green. And I'm going to go. I have faith that the guy on the other side, when he sees red, is going to stop. Doesn't always happen. You know, there's those things outside of our control. But promises need appropriate faith. Charles Spurgeon said, do not treat God's promises as if they were curiosities for a museum, but believe them and use them in everyday life. By the exercise of faith, God's promises become personal. Personal. So God made that promise for me, that if I, then I get. Hebrews 4:2 says, but the word which they heard did not profit them, not being mixed with faith in those who heard it. They didn't understand because of the lack of their faith. Faith. It's that thing that gets us beyond just belief. It's the thing that gets us to understand and incorporate. I mean, the Bible. How many of you understand it? How many of you understand all of it? I mean, there's still things I look at and I might question, but I know this. I got to believe it because it's his word. I mean, as a kid, I always said, really? So Samson took the jawbone of a donkey and killed 10,000 men with one jawbone. Here's my finite knowledge. Wouldn't that jawbone break? I mean, the first time you took that and hit someone, wouldn't it just crack? You would think? Who killed 10,000 men? God. Not the jawbone, not Samson, God. Samson was just the tool. We've got to get that into our minds. We are just a tool. This morning, I'm the tool that he's using to express his words to you. So that you understand that God has promises for you. Man, they are some great promises for you. If you would lay claim to them. If you knew what they were. If you accepted what you need to do to get them. The promise with us is this. We have no idea beyond 4 or 5 what the 8,800 promises are. How can you claim or work towards what you don't know? We've got to read. We've got to study. We've got to look into it. It took the man 2.5 years to go from front page to back page of the Bible and pull those promises out. His last statement in his book is, and it will take a lifetime to fulfill them all. One more time. Learn a promise, do the promise. Learn a promise, do the promise. Learn a promise, do the promise. Be a part of it, that you get it all in your life. And if you claim all 8,800 promises, how do you think your life's going to be? If you knew them all and lived them. Now, I'm talking to me, just about you. And I don't know the 8,800 promises. I know I can buy a book that's called the 8,800 promises and read them and start going through them. But I can start at the front of this book and read. And start pulling out and developing my list of those promises and what God wants from me and has for me if I would just be this way. You know, I don't know about you, but I stepped out into a center aisle of a church when I was in 7th grade. And I walked down an aisle, and I'm going to tell you, it seemed like the longest aisle in the world. Our church had 22 pews back. You know where we sat, don't you?
22.
In row 22. That's where all good Christians sit. The back row. And when we stepped out to go down that aisle, it was like, we are never going to get there. And we kept walking and walking. And it was just like, and we finally got in front and said, whew. But when I walked that aisle, when I came in front of Bob Green, who was the minister, and he asked me the question, do you believe in Jesus Christ, Son of God, do you accept him as Lord and Savior? I said, yes. Our scripture said today that all of Jesus is yes. And the yes is yes, no matter what happens. And I said yes that day. And the yes was, I promise. I promise to accept Jesus my Lord and Savior and to serve Him. Did you all likewise make that kind of statement? Did you accept Him as Lord and Savior? Did you say, now if He's Lord, I'm servant. I must serve. Day one, how'd it go? You remember? Day two. Can you remember when you stepped out and walked the aisle and accepted Him as Lord and Savior? Can you remember the things you did? I mean, it's so etched in my mind, I keep telling you guys, I can tell you the exact outfit I wore. I can tell you where we stood. I can tell you the actions that my brothers and I took and said, and ooh, you know, just all that. I made a promise that He would be my Lord and Savior the rest of my life. He has held up His end. He is always there. I can't say that was true with me. I mean, the rest of 7th grade and 8th grade and 9th grade and 10th grade. Oh man, you remember 11th grade? Well, Doug, you remember 11th grade, don't you? Or have you etched it out? Become so bad.
I think back a little bit.
Yeah, we remember certain things. We're like, oh gosh, you know. I can go through my life and I can go, ugh. Now trust me, there was a lot of good things in my life, a lot of good. But for some reason, what's stored in my little file cabinet brain is, man, when I blew it here, or I blew it there, or I blew this. And I don't remember them so that I can, ugh. I remember them so I don't repeat them. I remember them so that I can be different today than I was that day. I remember them because they're what pushed me on in Christ. Because I know what that was, and I know what I did, and I know that, and I don't ever want to be a part of, or do, or be, or say those things again. And so I push on. Now, wasn't perfect. Wasn't perfect the day I did it. Wasn't perfect the day after. Wasn't perfect enough. Man, I'm still not perfect today. But I'm a whole lot better than I used to be. Can you say that, Neil? A whole lot better than I used to be. And so we continue to push on, to fight the fight, to strengthen this relationship that we have, because I promised I would always be here for him, the way he promised he'd always be here for me. And so we push on and push on and push on. And when we fall, we claim that promise of what? Forgiveness. You know, it's not help, I can't get up. It's I fall and he says, come on. We got to keep going. We have things to do. We got souls to save. And so we push on. And in your life, promises come and you've got to grab onto them. You can't be passive with your promises. Hebrews 6:12, that you do not become sluggish, but imitate those who through faith and patience inherit the promises. Charles Finley, like this, the promises were made to be used by God's children, by all who would believe them and appropriate them into their lives. Proverbs 13:4 said, the sluggard craves and gets nothing, but the desire of the diligent are fully satisfied. The desires of the diligent are fully satisfied. You have to make sure that you're spiritually prepared to accept God's promises. If I had cherished sin in my heart, the Lord would not have listened to me. I can't serve two masters, one or the other. If I want to serve God and I want to have his promises and I want him to help me out in life, I've got to be his all the time. I can't harbor this sin in my heart and these other things and expect that he is going to continue to bless or give me the promises if I'm holding on to this. Let it go. Whatever it is, I'm standing before you telling me that I have these that I hold on to and I've got to let them go. And if I have them, I know you have them. You have things in your life that you're holding on to that it's just always been there. It's always been. Let it go. Let God work his promises in you. Final part of promises is holding on to the hope. Let us hold unswervingly to the hope that we profess, for he who promised is faithful. You need to persevere so that when you have done the will of God, you will receive what he has promised. Psalms 37, delight yourself also in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. It is followed by verse 7, rest in the Lord and wait patiently on him. He'll give you the desires, but wait. When those desires come, I mean, Abraham wanted a son, right? How well did he wait? What did it cause? Huh?
I said the Middle East.
The Middle East. There's truth behind that. I mean, Since that day, there has been that constant struggle because we didn't wait on God's promise. Hold on to hope. Be patient. Wait. In God's timing, He will. It's a promise. He will take care of us. He will hear our prayers. He will heal our land. We have to do our part. So this morning, if you're here, if you're not living on the promises, if you're not understanding what those are, I mean, just ask God this question. God, show me your promises. And He's faithful to do that. But be patient, wait in hope as He does it, because He might only show you one at a time. And it might be a while until you get that one down that He shows you the second. So patiently wait on Him. The only way to get His promises, though, is to have His Son. The only way to get His promises is to be His. And this morning we're going to do a hymn of invitation. It's an opportunity for you to accept Him as Lord and Savior. To accept Him and His promises He's made to you. This morning, if you have any doubt in your life where you'll end up, this is your opportunity to talk to Him and get it square. It's your opportunity to ask Him, you know, show me your ways, show me your promises, show me how I can be better in you. Maybe it's show me how to be better because it's the first time in your life that you're going to accept Him as Lord and Savior. Or maybe it's show me how to be better because you're trying and working towards being His, but we all need that little bit of help, don't we? So this morning, if you have a decision to make for Him, whether it's the first time or one heading towards Him, we make your decision today as we stand and as we sing.
Oh, so are you weary and troubled? No light in the darkness you see. There's light for a look at the Savior, and life for abundant and free.
Be able to raise our voices and praise, worship, honor, and love of you. Father, we just pray that everything we did and sang and said today were those things pleasing in your sight. Father, we ask now that you'll bless us, that you'll strengthen us, that you'll go with us, that Father, as we depart here, we could serve you out there. Father, guide and direct us. We pray this in your Son's name. Amen.